pay. If they won't shake the roots of the money tree, no go praying to the pristine altars. Waiting for the blessing with holy water. But the same old wealth and the same old hands, the same old people stay in command. What's your money go around? What's your money go around? They got it wrapped up tight, they got it safe and sound. What's your money go around? What's your money go around? She bought from Grace and hit the ground.
That was Paul Weller with the Style Council offering some pungent comments on the power of money. But Weller, who's often been described as being the most credible of today's rock stars, is himself one of the richest musicians to have emerged from the punk rock era. In our main interview this week, I spoke to Weller about what wealth does to a young musician. But first I asked him about the Jam. They may have had street cred, but didn't they lack humour?
No, I don't think that's true. We were, I suppose when you compare us to a lot of other people in the music business, we were quite dour, but that's just because we were quite ordinary, you know. I think, because I mean, most people in music are quite glittery characters, aren't they? Well, they seem to be, I don't know. But they're actually quite boring people, really. I mean, a lot of people in music, not only just in groups, but in music business, are very boring people, because it's all they've got, you know. Sometimes I feel sorry for them, because if you talk to them, that's all they can talk about is their little world, you know. And I'm probably, I'm on no exception really, but, so I think, you know, a lot of people are very boring in music. But I don't think the Jam were, you know, I don't think we were particularly more so than anyone else.
Do you find it difficult having your father as your manager? I mean, it's easy for you to tell a manager who you employ to sod off. I think it's a little difficult telling your father that, you know.
Yeah, well, maybe it would be, but
has it ever come to that?
No. You know, because it's he's always the one that with the spark of enthusiasm. There's been a lot of times, not so much recently, but say with the Jam, there was times where us three would get very despondent about what we were doing, and there'd be rows, and someone would leave, and we'd have a big ruck, and he'd always be the one who'd say, well, you know, forget about it, you know, because tomorrow you'll feel differently, and kind of always spur us on, especially in the early days. So I think for me, a lot of times, you know, like if he jacked it in, then I think, you know, I would think about it as well, because it's his enthusiasm for things which really influences me and inspires me sometimes.
Going from a builder to a manager of a mega rock and roll band couldn't have been easy for him.
Yeah, but, you know, but at the same time, I think it's great. I love the way that we kind of prove that anyone can do it, you know. Mm. You get all these kind of real stereotype managers in the music business. I think you have to come through different routes, you know. You have to work in a publisher's office, you know, in the 60s and have taken acid in a few times and hung around a few bands and, you know, whatever they do, you know, just like that boring stereotype thing. I mean, I think it's great the way that I always thought there was one of the greatest things about the Jam was the way that we just come from nowhere, you know, from the sticks and done it without having to go through all those routes, all those channels, those traditional channels. I always thought it was brilliant, you know. I thought it was like a real sort of to all those creeps, you know.
I suppose the Jam could be considered the first new wave band. I mean, you were the first band who, you always stood a little bit apart from punk.
Well, yeah, but only because we was kept out. We weren't allowed to join their gang, you know. I think that's what it was.
Why?
Well, because I think for silly reasons, really. I mean, the clothes for a start. And the fact that we took time to tune our guitars. We played more or less in tune and sung more or less in tune. There's silly reasons like that, you know. And I guess our approach was more obviously orthodox, you know. You could obviously tell it had come from where it had come from, the influence it had come from, you know. Mm. I mean, the Clash and the Pistols could both, obviously, you know, you could trace them back, but the way they presented it was a lot more different.
Did you want to become part of the gang?
Yeah, I did at the time because, I mean, I was like 18, 17 or 18 or whatever. And I just admired both of them groups so much and just what they said and what they'd done and the way they sounded and the way they looked and everything. And obviously I wanted to be part of that. I mean, after a while, I realised it was, you know, it was a lot of bullshit really, because a lot of them were just ex-art school boys, you know. So I realised that was a bit of a, sham.
Well, Strummer being an ex public school chap as well.
Yeah.
What do you think of the Clash now?
Nothing. Boring.
Are you a millionaire?
I'm not a millionaire, no. I didn't sell enough records to do that. You know, not when you think about, I mean, because like, most of these people make, you know, millions of pounds, you know, through American success. I mean, George must have by now, or, you know, people like that. But I mean, the Jam only sold records in England, really.
But you must be very rich.
Yeah, I'm not complaining about it, yeah.
What do you...
Yeah, I am rich, yes. I think I earn a ridiculous amount of money for what I do, you know, compared to other people who are doing far more worthy jobs. They earn nothing, they earn a pittance, you know. But that's this whole crappy system, this is just another part of it. I mean, what should I do? Should I go out and give everyone in the street a pound, you know, till I get rid of all my money? I mean, that wouldn't do any good either.
Can I talk to you a bit about your politics? There was that first NME interview that you gave, where you said that you would be voting Conservative. You also stood up for the Queen. You later recanted.
I still do, you know, in the National Anthem, I'm still there in my front room like this.
Because you're terribly patriotic, but I know you recanted on that.
I don't know if I am, yeah, actually. Am I?
I get the feeling that you're very patriotic.
I used to be. I'm not so much anymore. Not after the Falklands, right?
What? Well, can you explain that? I mean, life to you in Thatcher's Britain.
I think this government is quite different from many other previous ones we've had. And I think it's going to be... I think history will show that it is quite unique in that we've always had, like, politicians who have done their job badly, mainly, you know, mostly the time because they're stupid people. But I feel with Thatcher, she's not only doing her job badly, but she's calculated as well. And I find there's a real evil nature about the Tory party. And I think it's very, very different to what anything we've had before. You know, you can't compare it to any other, like you can't compare it to, like, Heath's government or, you know. And I think people should be aware of that and aware that it's different. It's not just like, she's not just another dodgy politician. It's something a little bit more calculated and more... I don't know what the word is. There's something definitely different about her and her party. The way that she's gathered all her cabinet around her and the people and the kind of people who've got some kind of, you know, dissension against her have been slotted out.
What would you advise as a youth spokesman?
Not a youth spokesman. You
well,
know.
You know, but...
One of these crummy cliches, well, you know.
No, that is... People do look up to you and listen to what you say, and they listen carefully to your advice. They listen
to you. Well, you better stop now, you know, and start speaking for yourself, because I think, you know, my overall message is this, that, you know, it's no good leaving your future and your life up to one politician and one party, or up to some pop group, you know. It's up to you, you know. People have got to become more responsible in that way. And seize their own lives and their own futures.
Well,